Once again, good morning to everybody. Yesterday we looked into the floating, how an element can be made a floating element, and that floating will be inside the another container. And also we can have multiple floating items. We can have inside a container side by side multiple floating elements. So this is the example we saw in the previous class. Whenever we have multiple floating items, the first one will float. Let us say, like in this particular example, there are six figures inside the article. Article is the container that we have. And inside the article we have six figures, and we have one paragraph. And all these figures, if you see their property, we have set float as left, means that will float to the left. So with given window size, as first object will float to the left and remaining will move to the right side. When resize is done, according to the resize, it will float again. Okay, this has float on two lines. This is the leftmost, first line and second line. Because the width is reduced, the height is increased. In the next one, the width is increased. So it will float in this particular line and rest will come to the right side. Okay, and let us say you don't want to float certain elements in that. How we can do it? We can use the clear property. Right now, all these figure is having the float left property, and for few figures or for few elements, you don't want to float. So what you will do is you will create a class selector, and you will say clear property. You will set it as left. And you can see all these figures have a property set float as left. So all are going to float, and these are multiple floats. And out of this particular figure, you can see here, we have set the class as first, and this will override the float and it will make it as a clear. So it will not allow this particular figure to float. So it will be displayed on the left. And you can see we have stopped floating of this also, the paragraph, because we have set the class is equal to first, and in the first we have set clear is equal to left. So this particular element will not float, and this particular figure will not float, and all other elements will float side by side. Okay, another problem that can occur with the floats is when an element is floated within a containing block that contains only floated content. In such case, the containing block essentially disappears. So what happens is, suppose you have a containing block, and inside the containing block, all the elements you have is everything is a float. So everything is a float element. If you have everything, all the elements inside the containing block as a float, the containing block essentially disappears, means we don't see the containing block. Example is this one. Okay, we have an article here. Inside the article, figure is there and one paragraph is there. And for this particular figure, so if you see this particular figure, certain property is set, and that figure property set is of property of float is set as left, figure caption is also set as left, and this is the property of the figure. Now you can see, and the first is first class selector is created, and here clear is set as left, and this first class is set to the paragraph. So this particular thing will not float, and whatever is inside the figure. So there are two things inside the figure. One is image and one is the figure caption. Both are floating. That is how you will see the container. Notice that the figure elements contents the area has shrunk down to zero, because all the elements inside it are having the property of float. So that is one problem. Whenever you have all the elements inside a container as floating, that particular container essentially it will disappear. So if you want to avoid that, okay, one solution would be to float the container as well. But depending on the layout, this might not be possible. A better solution would be to use the overflow property. Suppose if you don't want the containing block to disappear, one way of doing is we can make the container itself as the float. And another option what we can do is we can set the overflow property. You can see for the figure we have set the overflow as auto. Okay, so setting of the overflow property auto solves the problem. Now you can see the container which was shrunk in the previous example. You can see this is the container which totally disappeared by setting the overflow property for the figure, okay, as auto. You can you solve that problem. Now the whole container is appearing. Overlaying and hiding elements. Okay, overlaying, that is the if you want to show one element over the other element, or if you want to hide the elements, how to do that. So this is the most commonly required. Sometimes you want to overlay, or sometimes you want to hide. So one of the more common design talks with the CSS is to place two elements on top of each other, or to selectively hide and display element. Positioning is important to both of these tasks. So using the positioning, we can achieve that. Okay, positioning is often used to smaller design changes, such as moving items relative to other elements within a container. In such case, relative positioning is used to create positioning context for subsequent absolute positioning, the move. So using positioning context, we can do that. In this particular example, you can see here, this is the example where we have, this is the property for the figure that you have, the figure that you have, and this is the figure caption, and these are the different properties, background color, okay, color and opacity they have set. Okay, how opacity is, how opaque is that, and width, height and padding is set. Suppose if you want to overlay on each other, then you can say the figure position is a relative. So when you set the figure position as relative, it will follow the normal flow. As per the normal flow, the figure will be displayed. And for the figure caption, you have set the position as absolute. When you set the figure position as absolute, so from the positioned ancestor, it will be with relative to that, it will be positioned. So what is the ancestor? The figure is the ancestor here. With respect to that, it will be placed top 130 pixel, top 130 pixel, and left 10 pixel. So you can see the positioning of this figure caption will come here. Now, in the earlier case, the figure caption was here. Now it has overlaid the figure. So you can see the overlaying of the figure. This is how, using the positioning, we can do the overlay. This is another example. Here we have figure, okay. Inside the figure, I have one image and I have a figure caption for that image. And after that, I have one more image, okay. So you can see new banner.png. So this is the new banner.png that we have. Here you can see this part is a transparent, okay, only we have this as a new and the class that is set is overlaid. So the name given for the class is overlaid. and how the overlaid is that particular class selector is defined. The position is absolute. So when you say position is absolute, it will be moved out of the normal flow, and with respect to the ancestor positioned element, it will be positioned. With respect to the ancestor positioned element, it will, from top it will be 10 pixel, and from left it will be a 10 pixel. So this is how it will look like. When you use this particular display, what will happen, this particular image, it will, this figure will come up with the normal normal flow, and according to normal flow it will be displayed. And figure caption, I don't see any special thing that is set for the figure caption, so figure caption will follow the same thing. And this particular image, it uses this overlaid property, and according to overlaid property, so from this figure, from that position, it will move from top, it will move 10 pixel, and from bottom it will move 10 pixel. That is how it will be shown here. Now you can see the next example. In the next example, in the overlaid class selector, we have one more element attribute, display none. So when you have display none, this will hide the overlaid image. So this particular image, the new banner.png, it is placed on this particular image. If you set the display property as none, then it will disappear. Okay, so and better way to do, if you want to hide, the better way to do is you create one more class selector and you use the display none. And when you are specifying the image, like so you are specifying here class overlaid, you will specify class overlaid as well as hide. So it will have the property. What you will do is you will remove this display none from this overlaid, and you will put it in the hide, and you will provide the both the classes. Okay, this is a preferred way. Why this is a preferred way? You can use the semantic. So if you want to read the HTML document, it will clearly gives a sign that the particular image is hidden. In this case, it is not that clear. Hiding elements. So there are two ways to do it. Two different ways to hide the elements in CSS. One is the using the display property. We just saw, if we say display property as none, it will not be shown. So it will be hidden. That is the one way of doing it. The display property takes an item out of the flow, and it is as if the element no longer exists. So in case of when you set display as none, the item is completely taken out of the flow, so it is nowhere, it is present in that display. And there is another possibility of hiding an element, that is using the visibility property. The visibility property just hides the element, but the space for that element remains. So the difference between the display property and visibility property, both can be used for hiding. But in case of a display property, when you set display property as none, it will completely take out that element. That element will not exist at all. But if you say visibility property, if you say visibility as no, only what will happen is it will not be visible, but it will take that particular space. So these are the examples. One is, so two ways to hide. One is using the display, and another is using the visibility property. If you use display auto, okay, by default it will be shown. And if you say display none, okay, when you say display none for the figure, you can see here the figure is displayed. In the second, the figure is disappeared, and even that space is taken away. So here whatever the space was given for the figure, that is taken away, and after that we had one paragraph, only one paragraph is left out. Now the next example is here in case of a figure we have set the visibility as hidden. So in case of a visibility property, you make it as a hidden, the figure will get removed, so it will not be visible, but it will take that particular space. So that is the difference between the display property and the visible property, based on your requirement, how you want to hide. If there is a requirement to hide, one example for that is like if you are accepting any registration and there is a time bound for that, and after time bound you want to hide or disappear. So how you want to do, you can use either this, okay, or this property. So using hover to make thumbnails, okay. So next slide will show the combination of absolute positioning, the hover pseudo clause, and the visibility property can be used to display larger version of an image. So this is one example where it will show by just hovering on the a smaller image, we can create a larger image. This is the example. So in this particular example, you can see this is the HTML document that I have. In the HTML document, with all the HTML other regular tags like body and all those div, whatever you are using, we have these particular HTML tags. I have figure, and I am using a thumbnail class for this figure, and inside the figure, this is the opening figure and this is the closing figure tag. I have a image, okay, this is the image that is shown, and then I have the figure caption, and inside the figure caption, okay, this is inside the figure caption, this is the opening figure caption, class is equal to pop-up. Here figure has a class is thumbnail. For figure caption we have the class as a pop-up, and inside the figure caption I don't have a text. Normally we will put some kind of a text for the caption. Instead of a text, I have the image tag. You can see the image tag. And this image is larger than this particular image, what is shown here. Okay. And next I have is a one paragraph. The paragraph says the library in the British Museum in London. And this is the closing of the figure caption. So inside the figure caption, I have two elements. One is the image, one is the paragraph. Okay. And figure caption, the class is set as pop-up. And let us see this thumbnail and the pop-up. For the pop-up, okay, figure caption dot pop-up, okay, the figure caption dot pop-up, this will applies to this particular element. Padding is set, background position is absolute. So the we know when the position is absolute, it will be moved away from the normal flow, and it will be set according to the ancestor positioned element. And we have some property, okay, this is a giving some shadow to the frame, WebKit box shadow, Moz box shadow, and box shadow. These are the properties that are being set. And visibility is hidden. So when we have the visibility is hidden, even though that item is that element is present, it will not be visible. Okay, it will take the space, but it will not be visible. This is the fig caption dot pop up that will applies to this particular element. Fig caption dot pop up, and next one is figure dot thumbnail. then I have colon hover. Hover is the property. So when you hover, it will capture that. So this will define a figure dot thumbnail and hover, then fig caption dot pop up. So that time fig caption dot pop up, what will happen is the position is absolute, top 0, left 100. Okay, this is the new position. This here position is not specified. This is new position. Visibility is visible. So visible. So what will happen is when page is loaded, when the page is loaded for the first time, this particular property is taken, and whatever this item, figure caption item, this is made as invisible. So this is not visible. But when I hover over this image, when I hover over this image, this property will kicks in, where it will make it the position as absolute, and it will move the figure caption, okay, whatever the element that are inside the figure caption, that element will be moved from top zero, okay. Top zero means it will move in the same from here. Top zero means here only, and left 100 pixel, okay, and it will display, okay, and these properties are coming from here. So whatever the shadow properties are set, that will show up here, and it will display this bigger image. Okay, constructing a multi-column layouts. We talked about layouts. What are the other way we can create the layouts? So we talked about, everybody knows layout, right? How you want to put the layout for your page. What other methodology we have seen earlier? What thing can be used for the layout of a page? Layout of a page means you want to have a like upper, let's say, horizontal bar and sidebars on the left, right, central content and the footer, things like that. How can we achieve, anybody? If you remember, which HTML tag we can use to do that? Okay. So what we can do is, we talked about the HTML tables, okay, and we talked about the column span, row span, things like that. We can use, and inside the row of the table, we can have anything. We can have text, we can have image, we can have link, whatever the controls you want to put, you can put. So that is a one way of doing. So that is what we discussed when we talked about the table. The other way of doing is using the multi-column layout, or constructing a multi-column layout, is by using the floats. Okay, floating elements, and using the positioning of the elements. There is unfortunately no simple and easy way to create a robust multi-column page layouts. There are trade-offs with each approach. So for each approach, there is a trade-off, like some pluses and some minuses. So there is no one easy way. So using we can do the multi-column layouts either using the floats, or we can use the positioning. So how we want to position, normal, absolute, relative, whichever the way we want to use, we can use that. Most common way to create columns content is using floating. Okay, so using floats, the first step is to float the content container that will be on the left hand side. Remember that the floated container needs to have a width specified. When we specified the float, we had specified the width. Otherwise, what it will take? Otherwise, it will take the, by default, it will take the complete width of the window. So this is the most preferred way of doing the multi-column layouts, and we'll see with the example. So this is the example. Here you can see I have one header, and then I have a navigational element, then the main content. Inside the main content, I have some header h2, some figure, two paragraphs are there, then I have a footer. So ideally how I want to do it, I want have the header on the top and this navigation on the left, main on the right, and the bottom is the footer. Okay, this is if you use the normal flow of the browser, this is how it will be displayed. If we want to make it as a multi column like this, so you want to have a header here, and for navigation you can set the float property. So if you set the float as a left, this particular element, that is navigation element, will move to the left, and this main division will move to the right, and footer will remain there. So this is the just a block diagram example. This is the actual example. You have a navigation list. Navigation, it is just you have multiple things you want to provide as a navigational links that you have here. After that, I have a image, and then I have a paragraph. If you see, if I make this navigation as a float left, it will be floating to the left and rest will move to the right. Now this image, particular image, will move to the right. But if you see here, one problem is this particular navigational element has moved to left, but it doesn't have the complete content here. So this will readjust, so it will overlap on the div. How to avoid that? Okay, the other key step in changing the left margin so that the no longer flow back under the floated content. So what we can do, we can use the left margin to avoid the flow back under the floated content. So what is the meaning of that? This is flowing back under the floated content. Main division is flowing back under the floated content. If you want to avoid that, we can use the left margin. Now rest of the thing is same. This particular navigational element has float is set as left. Along with that, I will set the margin left. So margin hyphen left 220 pixel. Now it will give a margin. This will give a margin for this particular navigational element. Now you can see the visibility is much better than before. There is a no overlaying of the content. So this is the example. You can see the navigational panel or the bar on this side and rest of the content on the right hand side. This is one more example where we have more columns. This is the way normal flow would be: header, navigational, and a side section I have, and the main section I have, and the footer section. Normally how you want is header on the top, navigation on the left, aside is on the right hand side, main in the center, and then goes the bottom is the footer. How to do that? What you will do is you will set the navigational float, okay, float as a left, and also you will set the margin, left margin, and for aside you want to be on the right hand side, you will set the float as a right, float colon right, and you will set the right margin. How much width you want, you will set the right margin. So what will happen is this will flow to the left, navigation will flow to the left inside the same container, and aside will flow to the right, and the division will take the center space. Okay, and these margins, left margin of navigation and right margin of the aside, will make sure that there is no overlaying, and footer will come at the bottom. So also we can use the positioning to create a column. Positioning can also be used to create a multi-column layout. Typically the approach will be absolute position, the element that were floated in the example from the previous section. In the previous section, we looked into a float, okay, using float, how we can create multi-column. In the next section, we will see how we can use the positioning, okay, to create a similar multi-column layouts. Here example is, like earlier example is, for navigation, left float, aside, right float. Then we have left margin, and for the aside we have given the right margin. That is how it will be displayed. Okay, notice that with the positioning it is easier to construct our source document with the content in more SEO friendly manner. In this case, the main div can be placed first. So this positioning will also help in the search engine optimization. That is how we can use it. So here we can see we have a header. This is how, using a positioning, we can create a multiple column layout. We have the on the top header, then we have a container division. Okay, this division container contains three blocks: main, navigation, and aside section. And after this container, I have the footer. And how I want it to be displayed? I want header on the top, right? And then the complete container, And inside the container, I have three elements, main, navigational, and aside. Navigational section should come to the left, then division in the middle, and the aside on the right. How to do that? Using the positioning. So here we are not going to use the float, we are going to use the position property. First thing is for this div container. So you can see the main div container. I will set the position as relative. So, excuse me, what it will do is relative to the normal flow, let's say body, relative to that with a normal flow, this will be positioned. Okay, this particular div container will be positioned inside that div. First thing I have is a navigational section. For navigational section, what I will do, I will select the position as absolute. When we select the position as absolute, it will be moved out of the normal flow. And you are saying left 0, top 0. Means this is whatever the buffer with the normal flow we get. From here, with considering all that position, it will be placed from left 0 and from the top 0. So this particular navigational block or the element will be absolutely, it will be positioned here, irrespective of the change in the window size. It will automatically take up this position. And second, aside, it should be on the right hand side corner. Again, position is absolute, right is 0, top is 0. Here, left is 0. From left, it is 0. This aside is from right, it is 0, and top, it is 0. So it will be navigation will be corner to the left top, and aside will be corner to the right top. And this particular main that will be centered. Okay, it will be positioned in the center. And you can specify the left and the right margin. So whatever the width that is required for the navigational panel, you can set the left margin, and whatever the aside margin you want to set, you can set the right margin so that there is no overlaying. Okay, what would happen if one of the sidebars had a lot of content and was thus quite long? Okay. In the floated layout, this would not be a problem at all, because when the item is floated, blank space is left behind. So in case of a floated, if there is no content, blank space will be left behind. But when item is positioned, it is removed entirely from the normal flow. So subsequent items will have no knowledge of a positioned item. So this is the problem with the if there is a more content. So you can see here, the first one is elements that are floated leave behind the space for them in the normal flow. We can also use the clear property to ensure the element below floated element. So you can see this, whenever there is a float, if we don't use the clear, okay, if we don't use the clear, the floated item, in normal flow, automatically space is provided. So that is what happens in the float. But in case of a absolute, it goes out of the normal flow. Then such overlapping can happen. To avoid that, we can use the clear left property. So what it will do is it will make sure that this particular object is floated to the left. Okay. One of the biggest challenge that developers will have is the size of the screen, right? Whatever the, let's say if you are using tablet or laptop or mobile devices or some other kind of a devices, the size would be different. So when you are creating the web application, how to take care of that? So what approaches we can follow? Okay, for example, 21 inch widescreen monitor can display 1920x1080 pixels. Older iPhones, they support 320x480 pixel. Satisfying both is very difficult. The approach to take for one type of a site content might not work well with another site with a different content. So whatever the approach you are following for one particular screen might cause problem with the other, and taking care of all types of screen is very difficult. So there are different approaches the designers take, okay, to deal with the screen size problem. First one is the fixed layout, second one is the liquid layout, and third one is the hybrid layout. Basically, this is to take care of the different screen size and how you want to display your application inside those devices. So these are the three approaches we have. In case of a fixed layout, the basic width of the design is set by the designer, typically corresponding to an ideal width based on the typical monitor resolution. In this case, the width is set by the designer, taking into consideration some ideal width, okay, based on whatever the standards he will consider, and he will set that as a fixed width. The advantage of a fixed layout is that easier to produce and generally has predictable visual result. The advantage of having a fixed width is that whatever the visual things you see, it is highly predictable. This is how it's going to look for different kinds of screen, that is assured. But the drawback is if the screen is larger, excessive blank spaces you will see. Like you have designed for a particular size, and let us say you are looking it in the wider screen, you will see a lot of empty content without anything, blank space would be there, and it is highly unoptimized, okay? So to have a different kind of display on different thing, this is not a very optimized approach. This is one example of fixed layout. You can see for the div hash wrapper, that is the ID selector, we have specified the width. Width is 960 pixels. So that is how complete the web application width is going to be. And this is the body and div ID wrapper. That is what it is given here. Inside this division, we have all the HTML elements. And if by default, if we provide the like this, and let us say the window or the screen you are looking is larger than, width is larger than 960 pixel, you will see a lot of extra blank space, right? Your web application, your page will be displayed with a width of 960 pixels only. And this is kind of it will leave away a space by default on one side. And if you want to make it as have a equal blank space on other both the sides, you can set the properties margin left and margin right. And margin left, if you set it as auto, it will automatically take care whatever the total blank space, it will automatically adjust it into half for the left and half for the right. So if the particular width of the screen is let us say 960 pixels, the margin will not be taken, so there will not be any margin. If it is more than 960 pixels, then only the margin will be applied if you choose the auto. Okay, problems with the fixed layout. So you can see the problem here. this app is viewed, web application is viewed in a horizontal direction, this is how it will look like with the spaces all around. And when you tilt it to the vertical position, you will see some of the content has been removed because please hold on for a second. Next one is liquid layout. So earlier, in case of a fixed layout, you saw what is the advantage and disadvantage, how it will be shown. The liquid layout, it is also called as a fluid layout. Widths are not specified using pixels, but are specified as a percentage values. So we don't specify. In earlier case, the width was hard-coded as 960 pixel. So that particular web application will have, no matter what, 960 pixel width. But if you don't want to have a that kind of a layout, you can use the liquid layout where you use the percentage values. So you already remember the percentage values, how it works when you set width as EM, right, as a or a percentage with respect to the parent. Okay, when there is a resize of the window, automatically according to that it will resize. Okay, advantage, adapts to different browser sizes. Okay, if you have different browser sizes on different devices, it will automatically adjust to that particular browser size. There are certain disadvantages. Liquid layouts can be more difficult to create because some elements such as images have a fixed pixel sizes. So one problem with liquid layout is whatever the image we are providing, that image will, the size of the image will decide the width. So in that case, we will have the problem in resizing the image. In line length, which is an important contributing factor to the readability, may become too long or too short. The line length. So whenever you have a particular, when you have the web application and you want to enhance the readability, you come up with a specific line length which will have a better readability. But when the resizing happens, okay, when you use the liquid layout, either the length will become too long or it will become too short. So that will impact the readability. Here is the example. Fluid layouts are used based on the browser window. So this is the, with this particular window size, you can see the content is displayed according to this size. Definitely though, these widths are as per the percentages. Maybe this is like 25%, this is 25%, and maybe this is the 50% of the width. And when you increase the excuse me, when you increase the width, you can see relatively this particular the navigation bar is the size is increased, the main content is increased, and the aside bar is increased. So it is relatively it will increase. Then next one is the hybrid layout. So instead of using either a fixed layout or a liquid layout, we can go for the combination. Okay, hybrid layout is nothing but it combines the pixels and percentages for the measurement. So fixed pixel measurement might make sense for a sidebar. Okay, if you are having a sidebar, maybe you can use the a fixed pixel, because normally the content of the sidebars is normally fixed. Okay, when you are making your web application, you know, like you won't exceed in this particular example, we'll go back. See, this width, we don't need this navigation more than this, isn't it, right? Because we made this as a percentage, it is increasing here. This one in particular width is, we can have a fixed one. Okay, that is what it says. The sidebar column containing mainly graphic advertising images that must be always be displayed and which always are the same width, almost same width, that can be used as a fixed width. Percentage would make more sense for the main content or the navigation area, which perhaps min max size limits in the pixel set for the navigation area. So also what we can do is, you can set a fixed value. Okay, for here this makes more sense for main area to have a percentage, and fixed for the left sidebar or the right sidebar. And Also, on top of that, you can set a minimum limit and the maximum limit. If you don't want to squeeze in too much, you can set the minimum or maximum layout. That approach you can follow. Okay, a responsive design. So we'll see the responsive design in the next class. I will go with the attendance.